righteous in all his ways, and holy in all his works. The Lord is nigh to all them that call upon him, to all that call upon in his truth. God, our Father, we thank you, Master, for every good and perfect gift. We thank you, God, for this blessed Sunday, O God, that we come to worship you in spirit and in truth, O God, as we come to celebrate, O God, in this first Sunday of July, O God, as we celebrate Independence Day, O God. And God, we are thankful, O God, that in us are indeed, we are free indeed, O God. Help us, O God, now that we may worship in the power of your holiness, O God. Draw us nearer and nearer to thee, O God. Let your Holy Spirit run from heart to heart and breast to breast. O God, Master, usher us into your presence, that we may worship you in spirit and in truth. And Father, we'll give you praise, we'll give you glory, we'll give you honor for all that you shall do. For we ask this prayer in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
Thank you.
tonight just to know that Jesus stayed right there, not because he got tired, not because he wanted it another way, but he did it just to save you and I. God, our Father, we come once again in Jesus' name, God. Father, we thank you afresh, O God, for your rich and your many blessings, O God. We thank you for your sacrifice there at the cross of Calvary, O God. And, O God, we realize that so many choices you could have made. But, O God, we thank you that you decided to stay right there, O God. That you hung, bled, and died for our sins. That one day we will recognize that we needed a Savior. And thankfully, with God, that you died, but early the third day morning, you rose from the grave with all power of heaven and earth in your hands. We're thankful for it, for it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. This morning, we want to continue in our series of services found in the book of 2 Kings, chapter 7. This morning, I want to begin reading in verse number 1. Again, the 2 Kings, chapter 7. I want to read again, beginning at verse number 1. Elijah replied, "Listen to this message from the Lord. This is what the Lord says. By this time tomorrow in the market of Samaria, 6 quarts of choice flour will cost only 1 piece of silver, and 12 quarts of barley grain will cost only 1 piece of silver." The officer assisting the king said to the man of God, that couldn't happen even if the Lord opened the windows of heaven. But Elijah replied, "You shall see it happen with your own eyes, but you won't be able to eat any of it." Now there were 4 men with leprosy sitting at the entrance of the city gates. "Why should we sit here waiting to die?" they asked each other. "We will starve if we stay here. But with the famine in the city, we will starve if we go back there. So we might as well go out and surrender to the Armenian army. And if they let us live, so much better. But if they kill us, we would have died anyway." So at twilight, they set out for the camp of the Armenians. But when they came to the edge of the camp, no one was there. For the Lord had caused the Armenian army to hear the clatter of speeding chariots and galloping horses and the sound of a great army approaching. The king of Israel had hired the Hittites and the Egyptians to attack us. They cried one to another. So they panicked and ran into the night, abandoned their tents, horses, donkeys, and everything else as they fled for their lives. And when the men with leprosy arrived at the edge of the camp, they went in to one tent after another, eating and drinking wine, and they carried off silver and gold and clothing and hid it. And finally, they said to each other, "This is not right. This is a day of good news, and we aren't sharing it with anyone. If we wait until morning, some calamity will certainly fall upon us. Come on, let us go back and tell the people of the palace." And so they went back to the city and told the gatekeepers what had happened. We went out to the Armenian camp, and they said, "And no one was there. The horses and donkeys were tethered, and the tents were all in order, but there wasn't a single person around." Then the gatekeepers shouted the news to the people in the palace. Amen. Thus ended the reading. The grass withered and the flower faded, but the word of our God shall stand forever. For just a few minutes, y'all, on this 4th of July, I want to talk about it's time to make a move. It's time to make a move. In our text, as we shared on last week, we visited this passage as it relates to this tragedy that was happening among the people of Samaria. The word had gone forth that the Syrians had attacked the city of Samaria. They had closed the gates and no one could go in and no one could come out. And so it paralyzed them, for there was no food, there was no productivity, there was no sense of work to be accomplished because no one could leave the city gates. The word had gone forth as to how bad and how terrible it was. And I would argue, my brothers and sisters, the Bible says even the word of God had gone forth unto them, and the Bible says that Elijah declares the word of God and tells him by this time on tomorrow. He said that's going to be a change in the market. And he says there 6 quarts of choice flour will cost only 1 piece of silver. 12 quarts of barley grain will only cost 1 piece of silver. This was a dramatic change to what they had experienced before, because they were recognizing that donkeys' heads were being sold for high, expensive prices. And the word is that God had sent a word that was going to change their circumstances. And I want to honor my brothers and sisters. God hadn't stopped sending his word. He's still trying to change things in our lives. And ultimately, we've got to believe the word of the Lord. The Bible says when the word had gone forth, that there was a captain there that represented the king. And when he had heard the word of Elijah, he asserted to the prophet, and he said unto them that this could never happen, even if God opened the windows of heaven. And I would argue, my brothers and sisters, there always will be doubters of what the Lord can do. But I declare to you that God got to have some kind of witness that would declare that the God we serve is able to deliver us. The main point of our text is found around verse 3 and further. For the Bible says that there, after God had declared his word, that there were 4 lepers sitting around the gates. And the Bible says that they were lepers, and they were filled with a disease that would affect them for the rest of their lives. They were at the gate, and the Bible says that there they remained there, and they had conversations one with another. And I would argue, my brothers and sisters, the Bible says that when they looked at what was happening, that they began to converse one with another. They recognized that the disaster. But listen, they went and investigated their dilemma. For the Bible says that they thought about this whole thing, and they said that where we are, we've ultimately got to do something about it. He argues that where we are, if we go back, if we retreat and go back to the city, he says that won't do us no good, because they are dying in the city. They are falling of starvation, and why should we go where we've always been? If they hadn't helped us in this time, they will not help us now. Because oftentimes for a person that was filled with leprosy, the only way that they would really receive food is that their families would meet them at the gate of the city, and that they would provide food for them. But oftentimes families would do it despairingly, because they will feel the effect of going to see someone with leprosy. And yet they declared within themselves, these 4 brothers, they discussed within themselves that we don't need to go backwards, because we know that there is nothing there for us. But then they argued that we cannot sit right where we are. And I would argue, my brothers and sisters, sometimes even in the life of the church, we can become complacent with where we are. We know where we've been, and we got excitement for where we've been. But listen, we have no idea where we're going. We have no expectation of God, of what he shall do
in our lives. And the Bible says that they are faced with this dilemma. Shall we go back or shall we stay where we are? And if we stay right there at the gate, nobody's coming in and nobody's going out. So ultimately we have death right where we are. But they had a third choice. They recognized that they could go forward, but they would have to go into the enemy's camp. What do you do when all that's left to you is to go to the enemy's house? What do you do when you know that the enemy don't want you either? Which way do I take? And the Bible says they wrestled within themselves, and they recognized that their best way out was to move and go forward. I will argue, my brothers and sisters, every now and then, you've got to recognize that God has given us some choices, and we've got to decide that now is the time that we've got to make a move. I remember some years ago, I was stationed in Japan, and a friend of mine, we were discussing, he was on his way to go back home to the United States, and he invited me to go up on a trip up in the Alps, and we were to go skiing, and I'd never gone skiing before, and I yet told him that I would go, and he told me that on the way there, that he needed me to take his car back, because he was going to catch a plane from there. Well, what he didn't tell me was that the car that he had was a stick shift. Never driven a stick shift in my life, and after we got there, he began to give me some pointers of what to do, and I said, man, this ain't enough time for me to get this car from the mountain peaks all the way to where we're going, and so after we had our fun skiing, I got in his car, didn't know what to do, but all I know is what he showed me to do, and I remember it cranking and putting it in the first gear, and it whined and whined, and I kept listening. I said, this is something you can change. And I couldn't remember how he told me to do it, but finally my foot moved in a way that I didn't know it could move, and finally I pressed it, and it moved me from first gear to second gear. And then finally I would hear it wind up again. And I something told me that it was to change gears, and I would move from first to second to amen, the third gear. And listen, I would argue, my brothers, something inside of me, driving a car that I never driven before, told me it was time to make a change. I would argue, my brothers and sisters, I don't care where you are in life scale, God maybe is moving in your life, and maybe he's telling you that it's time for a change. The Bible says that they decided that they will make a change for their lives, and that they will go to the army's camp. And so they waited down to the break of the evening. The Bible says that thus they decided that they would go down to the enemy's camp. They knew that danger would be afforded them, but yet they went on anyway. And the Bible says that on their way there, perhaps they're talking to one another as to what they would say to the enemy, how they would act and interact. And yet the Bible says that when they got there, a strange thing happened. The Bible says when they got there, no one was in the camp. The Bible says on their way, these four lepers, on their way there, the Bible says God allowed a strange sound to happen, that the men and women of the Armenian community, they thought it was a vast army coming. Four men, but it sounded like a vast army. Listen, they sound like horses coming their way. It sounded like a chariot coming their way that ultimately would destroy them. For they thought that they had met up with other armies to confound them. And the Bible said when they heard it, they left all of their goods. They left all of their food. They left all of their clothing. They left all of their jewels right there and ran for their lives. I want to argue, my brothers and sisters, if you go with God, God will make provisions on your behalf. But listen, you can't get it until you first get up from where you are and go to where God is moving. The Bible says, on the way that God made a move on their behalf, and the Bible says, they not only affected the disaster, not only did they have a dilemma, but they made a decision. They made a decision that they were going to go into the enemy's camp. And thanks be to God that when they made a deciding factor for God, listen, the Bible said God showed up for them. For the Bible says that when they got there, they discovered that no one was there. When they got there, they discovered that God had bathed the hand of the enemy. God had kept them abased. And I would argue, my brothers and sisters, if you walk with God long enough, you'll discover that God will fight your battles. Just hold your peace. Listen, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. They discovered as they entered the camp that the camp had been totally abandoned. And the Bible says there they found refreshment. The lepers, I can see them one moving to another. In one camp, they found beverages there. And listen, and they could drink to the heart content. And listen, I don't know what they drank, but I do know they had refreshments on that day. But then, my brothers and sisters, the Bible says that not only did they drink, but they ate. The Bible says that in the tent there were all kinds of food. One of my old pastors used to say they had taters and maters. They had green beans and black-eyed peas. And listen, they had turkey and dressing and macaroni and cheese. Listen, it was all laid out for them. Listen, I want to tell you something, y'all. Sometimes God will bless you. He'll give you something that you didn't work for. He'll give you something that you didn't earn. He'll give you something that you didn't have to lay one hand to make it happen. The Bible says he provided everything for them. The Bible says that these lepers, who had nothing to receive from those of their own families, they moved from their war and they go into the enemy camp, and God allowed them to be blessed. But notice this, y'all. They moved from one tent to another tent. The Bible says in the next tent, they had all of their ravens there. Listen, they left all of their, Jacob's shoes. They left all of their men's shoes. They left all of their elements there. And listen, and I can imagine these lepers not having anything for so many years. They began to put on everything that they could put their hands on. New shoes and new hats and new clothing. Listen, they shake themselves. And the Bible says that they moved from one tent to another tent. And their jewels are there. All of the jewels that they had set up for a lifetime now has been laid up for them. Oh, I want to honor my brothers and sisters. Don't tell me what God will do. If you just walk with the Lord, if you allow him to open doors for you, God will do so that no man can close. The Bible says that as they come among themselves, the Bible says that they ate to the well-eaten. The Bible says they got all kinds of clothes on. They got all kinds of the finest jewels on. And the Bible says that as if something comes across them. And the Bible says that it causes them to rethink this thing. They got raiments and they got refreshments. They got clothes and jewelry. But the Bible says that they thought within themselves, how is it that we can have all of this and there are those in the city of Samaria who are starving to death? How can we have all of these tomatoes and grains and milk and honey? We have all of this available to us, and yet there is somebody else that wouldn't even give us a piece of bread, but yet they're hungry over there. And they decided within themselves, is something wrong with us to eat all of this, to take all of this, and not even can put it all together, and yet there are those that are starving in the gates. And they decided for themselves that I believe I'll go back and tell them in the city gates of what the Lord has done for me. I would argue, my brothers and sisters, I don't care how great you are, but listen, God didn't give all of that to you for you to just feast on all by yourself. Listen, God desired to bless us that we might be a blessing to somebody else. The Bible says that they went back to the gates and they declared unto them, y'all, I know you've been here a long time. I know that you were just as hungry as we were, but something awesome that happened to us. We went over to the enemy's camp, and that they meant for evil became our good. And the Bible says that we saw all kinds of stuff. We saw all kinds of food. We saw all raiment. We saw all kinds of jewelry. But listen, y'all, what we didn't see was nobody was in the camp. Bible says that the master of the gate, the officer of the gate, got so happy, he went to tell everybody in the gate of what God had done for them. Listen, I want to argue. When God's been good to you, it makes you want to tell somebody. When God has blessed you and made a way out of no way for you, it'll make you want to tell somebody. Listen, this is what the Lord has done for me. The Bible says a strange thing happened. That king decided. He said, wait a minute. Bible says he woke up in the middle of the night and he said that, wait a minute, they may be waiting for us to come. He says that he sent out an entourage to go and look and go farther than the camp. The Bible says they didn't find nobody, that all they found was the loot that they left behind. The Bible says that the king sent forth the same messenger that told Elijah this would never happen. It's the same one the king sent to the gate, and he wanted him to give an account for everything that was brought into there. And the Bible says everything that Elijah said came to pass. That everything that was to be bought at a certain price was sold that day. Everything that was to be bought at another price, it was sold at that price on that day. But the Bible says one other thing happened. It said the people got so excited in coming that the man, the officer who was to patrol them, the people bum rushed him and he was killed at the gate. He saw it happen, but he couldn't get any part of what God. Listen, I want to argue y'all. You got to be careful what you declare God wants you. Because listen, if you don't have the faith to believe it, God won't necessarily give. Listen, I just want to argue, my brothers and sisters. Listen, all of this happened because of four men decided that I want to go for gold. I want to go for what I know. And they made God made a difference in their lives, so much so that they shared it with someone else. I declare to you that I'm so glad that we serve a God that even his only, sending his only begotten son, he didn't send him just because he was sin. He saw, but listen, Jesus went the extra mile. The Bible says as he was in the Garden of Gethsemane, he declared that, Father, bid this cup to pass from me. But he declared, not my will, but thy will be done. The Bible says one Friday, they didn't take away his life, but he gave his life for your life and for my life. That one day that we will need salvation. And listen, and only the blood of Jesus can wash away our sins. Thanks be to God that not only did he die, but he rose again the third day with all power of heaven and earth in his hands. And I'm going to argue, that's good news this morning, even on this Independence Day, that you will know the joy of your salvation, not because of what you've done, but because of what Christ has done in your life. God, our Father, we come in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for every good and perfect gift that comes from the up above. Bless now our time together. And oh God, I pray that there may be someone under the sound of my voice, oh God, who's looking, who's searching, oh God, trying to grab an understanding, oh God. And oh God, I would argue, my brothers and sisters, that dilemma is not all by themselves. But oh God, we know that if they trust you, oh God, that you will make a way somehow, oh God. Don't know when, don't know where, don't know how, but we know, oh God, that you would work it to our good, oh God. And Master, if there's one that never repented of their sins, never trusted you as their Lord and Savior, do it today, oh God. And we'll be faithful to give you glory, to give you honor, and to give you praise. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Thank you. describe it today for yourself. Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.